Well, the RTX 5080 is here, and let me just read my notes. It's magical, stupendous, game-changing. Wait a minute, or is it? Look, after taking some time with NVIDIA's more attainable enthusiast GPU and gaming, etc., and running it through our battery of benchmarks, it left us with one question. Is the RTX 5080 good enough for you? And we're gonna tell you all about it right here, right now on Robeytech. Well, right after a word from our sponsor. Another innovation from Main Gear that I cannot wait to get my hands on is the new Apex Rush. This is a PC that lives at the intersection of artistry and engineering. Featuring RTX 50 series graphics, the Apex Rush is gorgeous and powerful, but it also has some practical features that set it apart. From easily accessible filling and drain ports to multiple customization options and symmetrical cooling runs. The Apex Rush, it takes Main Gear's obsession with clean lines, cool components, and sheer simplicity to create one showstopper of a PC, and I cannot wait for you to check it out. But if you want more details right now, check out Apex Rush over on maingear.com today, or check out the link in the description below. Now, we realize that asking if the RTX 5080 is good enough is a really subjective question, because everyone is going to see value differently. I mean, remember our 5090 review, and we talked about the beautiful lady or ugly hag, depending on how you looked at the same picture? Well, if you're looking at this as the long-awaited upgrade from your GTX 1080, then yeah. But if you're looking at this as a colossal step up from the RTX 4080 or 4080 Super into glorious, like godlike RTX 4090 type performance, you might want to lower your expectations a bit. When you look at the spec for spec comparison between the 4080 and 5080, which isn't entirely one-to-one when you consider different generation of core components, but the whole picture isn't so different, and we're just not seeing the bump in things like the amount of VRAM or memory interface width that we saw in the 4090 to 5090. Fortunately, we also didn't see a price bump here either, which that can be a pro. If we sound a little tepid to our reception of the RTX 5080, it's not because it's necessarily a bad GPU, we just left with a few more questions than answers. And with this being the enthusiast grade $1,000 GPU, there are a number of those questions that we need to have answers to, like, how does the 5080 perform in comparison to the RTX 4080 Super? Is the experience with DLSS 4 and multi-frame generation as magical as it was with the 5090, or is the experience downgraded from NVIDIA's flagship GPU? And if it is, does that spell doom for the 5070 family? And if you were considering an RTX 5080, what would be considered an upgrade with where things stand in our data today? So there are a number of questions that we need to answer. Some of those we will answer in this video, and some we'll need more time on, but we're able to explore each of those thanks to NVIDIA, because they did send us a 5080 Founders Edition for our review, and it would be rude of us not to say thank you. So thanks, NVIDIA. Before we get to the numbers, we need to give you a quick reminder. All the numbers we're gonna show you are not concrete numbers. See, we're testing the RTX 5080 on pre-release drivers on titles that may not yet be updated or optimized for this GPU yet. All this means is that reviews like this one are ongoing, and you should always try to get a complete picture of how something works after day one before spending any money on it. We have some long-term plans to keep you in the know about the 50 series experience, and we're excited to bring those to you and really test the experience the way it should be tested. Now, some of those discoveries we actually have to talk about before we even get to the RTX 5080. Now, since our RTX 5090 review, we discovered a few errors in our RX 7900 XTX data as we validated results for this review. This is one of those times where our humanity is showing, and as diligent as we are to make sure we're giving you as accurate information as possible, unfortunately errors happen, and we're sorry we didn't catch it earlier. That wasn't the only thing we discovered, and I think a lot of you commented on this on our 5090 review. You probably noticed that we made the choice to use the Intel Core Ultra 9 285K as our test bench CPU versus the AMD Ryzen 7 9800X3D or the Intel Core i9 14900K. As we were testing, we discovered that games like Indiana Jones and Star Wars Outlaws weren't quite sure what to do with the combination of GPU and CPU. Now, we confirmed this with the 14900K test bench using the 5090 to validate, and sure enough, these games just didn't like the 285K. Now check this out. In Indiana Jones, the 5090's performance jumped from 89.7 frames per second at 1440p to over 191. And in Star Wars Outlaws, the jump were even more significant, from just under 50 frames per second to an average of over 140. Before you go and dumpster the 285K, we also discovered that Cyberpunk isn't a big fan of the 14900K as it is the Core Ultra CPU. See, the 14900K's performance with the RTX 5090 dipped from just over 194 frames per second on Core Ultra down to 157 on the 14900K. These are not insignificant differences here. And what's also wild is that when we jump into the test branches for these games, believe it or not, at least for Star Wars Outlaws, the issue went away with the 285K. So what does that mean for this review? It means that we're going to go ahead and omit Star Wars Outlaws and Indiana Jones from our charts until the issue is resolved. And this just goes to show that some of the quirks of day one reviews, that this is just one of those fun things you discover when you're testing something new. All right, so that was a lot of exposition, sure, but it was needed. And now you're probably excited because here are the numbers, and thanks to our illustrious tech director, we have them here for you. So right up front, I'm gonna tell you that we saw a similar story to what we saw in our 5090 review, an overall uplift with some caveats. In raw performance at 1080p, we saw the RTX 5080 perform on average 6.2% better than the 4080 Super and around 19.1% better over the XTX. Here we saw games like Black Myth Wukong and Forza Horizon 5 showing the biggest difference in performance. Meanwhile, the 4080 Super did have an ever so slight lead in Space Marine 2. At 1440p, we saw the RTX 5080's performance level up with a 12.2% average lead over the RTX 4080 Super and a 19.7% lead over the 7900 XTX. Again, Forza and Wukong showed the biggest percentage lead over the RTX 4080 Super, but the 5080 did fall slightly behind Hogwarts Legacy, just enough that we could call this one even. And at 4K, we saw the RTX 5080 take another leap ahead of the RTX 4080 Super's performance by an average of around 18.1%, while continuing its double-digit lead over the 7900 XTX by 18.4%. Now, just a quick note here, because we're dealing with lower frame rates, percentage gains are going to look a whole lot bigger here. Now, the biggest standouts for 4K performance gains over the 4080 Super were Cyberpunk, Forza, Marvel Rivals, and of course, Starfield. Now, when we start adding in upscaling, we start getting a bigger view of the RTX 5080. Keep in mind, we're only looking at 1440p and 4K here. At 1440p, the RTX 5080 continues its leadership over the RTX 4080 Super's performance by an overall average of around 6.4%. which is a slimmer delta than in raw performance than before. Now the XTX follows a similar trend here, but the 5080 still took an 11% lead over its performance. But unlike raw performance, we see the 5080 lose ground in Hogwarts by a slim margin while wrestling control of Space Marine 2. At 4K, we see a similar story when comparing the RTX 4080 Super with the 5080. The delta between raw performance and the introduction of DLSS causes the gap to close ever so slightly between the two. However, we do see the 5080 leapfrogging the RTX 4080's performance in Hogwarts Legacy, giving the 5080 around an overall 8.3% bump over the RTX 4080 Super at 4K with DLSS enabled. As for the XTX, the difference between DLSS and FSR highlights just how powerful DLSS is comparatively with the 5080, exceeding the 7900 XTX's performance by an average of just shy of 33%. Now, when we look at upscaling plus DLSS frame generation or AMD's fluid motion frames, the delta between the 5080 and 4080 Super gets a little closer, with the 5080 seeing around a 12.5% uplift over the 4080 Super at 1440p and 16.8% at 4K. Meanwhile, the absence of fluid motion frames and FSR from two of our seven titles, the 5080 saw around 10.8% uplift at 1440p and 16.1% uplift at 4K over the 7900 XTX. However, the 7900 XTX just wouldn't let go of Modern Warfare 3. What can I say? COD loves AMD. Now, when we're talking about testing multi-frame generation, we took the same approach we did with the RTX 5090. We turned everything on. We talk about path tracing, ray reconstruction, DLSS transformer, the highest possible texture settings at 4K. So for our data in Alan Wake 2, we saw around 160 frames per second. In Cyberpunk 2077, Night City looks stunning at 183 FPS. In Dragon Age Veilguard, we saw around 214 frames per second. And in Marvel Rivals, the average was 281 frames per second. Now, as far as uplift percentage goes, understand that when we're looking at raw numbers or even with DLSS without frame generation, keep in mind that we have everything turned up at 4K. And when we do, the 5080 has struggled under the heavy load of ray tracing and path tracing without the support of DLSS. Now, while we saw the RTX 5090 landing around 60 FPS or higher, the 5080, not so much. So the disparity between raw performance and multi-frame generation is going to be more exaggerated here. For example, in Cyberpunk 2077, running with ray tracing overdrive, the 5080 eked out a meager average of about 18 frames per second. So when compared to the 183 it averaged with multi-frame generation, it looks like a 917% uplift. But to be clear, it was only averaging around 52 frames per second with DLSS and no frame gen. As far as our other titles, we saw 196% uplift in Alan Wake 2 between DLSS 3 and DLSS 4 with multi-frame generation on. In Dragon Age Veilguard, we saw around a 214% uplift, and in Marvel Rivals, we saw an uplift of around 195%. So with all of this data considered, and there is a lot of data, where does that leave us with the RTX 5080? Raw performance shows an uplift over the RTX 4080 Super, which is great. But it doesn't get us close to the RTX 4090 performance we'd hoped for and kind of had seen in the past with the 3090, etc. With how much hype NVIDIA drummed up about massive leaps in performance with the multi-frame generation asterisk, it just seems to kind of put a cloud over the RTX 5080. Making matters even more cloudy is how the RTX 5080 performed at 4K. With the raw numbers we're seeing, it doesn't give us confidence recommending the GPU for 4K gamers, especially if they're playing graphically intensive cinematic titles. Now, it's on the cusp with DLSS, but this comes down to what you prefer as a gamer. Now at 1440p, the 5080 does well for itself by either meeting or exceeding the 60fps threshold on pretty much anything. When we look at the raw performance numbers, the 5080 feels more like a 4080 Ti Super than a true generational leap. But Robey, what about those high frame rates with multi-frame generation? I thought you loved it. And to that I'd say you're right. There is something that is still magical about multi-frame generation, and we still believe it holds value as a feature. Our first experience with it felt far more natural than the standard frame generation thanks to the 50 series hardware-based flip metering. While if you're not familiar with what flip metering is, the TLDR is it moves the frame pacing logic from the CPU, which is how DLSS 3 frame generation was handled, onto the GPU's display engine. What this does is it helps make the delivery of extra frames more precise, and in some ways, it just feels more natural. But as impressive as DLSS 4 and multi-frame generation have been, we're also running into a situation here where benchmarking tells a story, but it doesn't actually tell the whole story. When we look at understanding the whole story for the RTX 50 series GPUs, we just need more time with the GPU to really figure out if what we're seeing will carry over into titles outside of our testing. We also need to make sure that what we're measuring is truly accurate to the post-launch user experience and whether multi-frame generation can be a legitimate proxy or replacement for raw rendering. The difference is that substantial between DLSS 3 and DLSS 4, but the answer could actually be maybe, but we need to test that and really experience it. So as much as you're going to hate the wait, we're gonna make plans to test the RTX 5080 on a day-to-day basis for about 3 to 4 months to see just how much of a difference features like multi-frame generation will make and if it will actually work for someone looking for a 4K gaming GPU by replacing a 4090 with this and saying, does the experience suck if you play it over a long period of time? Now, if you're not satisfied with that as an answer to your original question, here's what we're gonna tell you. Is the RTX 5080 good enough? That depends on what you're comparing it to. If your games are running fine on the GPU you have, you don't need this card, especially if you're running on a 4070 Ti or higher. Would you see an uplift in performance from an RTX 4080 or a 4080 Super? Absolutely. The 5080 shows around a 12 to 18% bump in raw performance at 1440p and 4K. But if you just bought an RTX 4080 Super or you're currently running an RTX 4080, the way we see it is that it's really hard to justify a jump. Unless, okay, there's always a caveat, unless there's some upgrade here that you need. And I said need in terms of there's a game, like a game that needs faster GDDR7, which we don't see, but maybe it is multi-frame generation, and multi-frame generation is an experience that you've experienced yourself and you love it and you know you like it. And then in that case, it might make sense. Now the big question, and the one we hope to answer in time, is about multi-frame generation and AAA titles as they become more and more popular in the market. Remember, DLSS is turned on by over 80% of users, and this is something that, I mean, with 70 titles already getting support, and we have titles like Doom the Dark Ages, and so many other AAA games that are going to be adding these features in, and they're gonna be natively there, and they're not gonna be added retrospectively. So the only potential path for a 4080 user and maybe even a 4070 Ti user is that if multi-frame generation plus the experience in the game in those titles at 100 plus FPS is going to be worth that jump. Again, and unfortunately for those of you watching the review, time will tell if that theory holds water for you. Now, if you're on a 30 series GPU or making the jump from AMD, that's another story entirely. But remember, the only one who can really assign the GPU's value for you is you. And if the RTX 5080 looks like the next GPU that you want, awesome. We hope that you love it and it fuels countless incredible gaming sessions. But if it doesn't look great for you, it is literally your money and you can spend it however you see fit or don't spend it. At the end of the day, closing it all down, NVIDIA did technically give us an upgrade for the RTX 4080 with the RTX 5080, but I think everybody was hoping, including us, that we would see a leapfrog for the 40 series hierarchy that we didn't actually see. Also, we're still kind of unpacking the full scope of what an upgrade actually means with this generation of GPUs as it's defined by NVIDIA, because the way that the hardware, the technology, and the software all work together, paired with the way that game development is now happening and all of its support with AI, whether you like it or not, that's all stuff that has yet to be discovered, and it's definitely gonna make more time. So that wraps this one up, but this won't be the last time that you're seeing the RTX 5080 or any of NVIDIA's RTX 50 series family here on Robeytech. And we also obviously wanna say thank you to NVIDIA for giving us the opportunity to check out the RTX 5080. But these were our thoughts, but we wanna know what you think. Did you see enough of a performance game from the 4080 Super to the RTX 5080? Do features like DLSS 4 and multi-frame generation lower the threshold for what you would consider an upgrade? And are you considering the RTX 5080 as your next GPU? And are you in line at Micro Center right now? Let us know down in the comments below. Now, while you're down there, make sure you slap that subscribe button, whip that like button, and ring that notification bell so that you get a notification each and every time we post a video like this right here on Robeytech. And if you want to continue the conversation, maybe you want to find other like-minded tech and PC enthusiasts to talk about this with, head on over to our Discord server, discord.gg/Robeytech. It's actually an amazing place to talk to other people about this. And you know what? You might just make a friend. Also, follow us on all the other socials at Robeytech, absolutely everywhere. Thank you so much for watching this video. We look forward to seeing you on the next one.